Between 1491 and 1607, North America evolved from a continent populated solely by Native Americans, who developed a distinct, complex societies by interacting with each other and the environment, to a continent colonized and controlled by one of the newest European powers, Spain. North America will have a vast amount of natural resources and seemingly unlimited ways to make any country rich. Because of this, the other European powers will be waiting in the wings for their chance to colonize the New World. But for now, they'll have to wait. For this unit focuses primarily on the collision of cultures between Spain and the Native American societies. This video will slightly go beyond 1607 in order to discuss how one native society fights back to attempt to preserve their remaining cultural heritage. In this video, we will discuss how and why native populations interacted with the natural environment in North America, the causes and the effects of European exploration. We'll discuss the cultural confusion surrounding contact between Native Americans and the European population. We'll also talk about how the Columbian Exchange changed both the Americas and Europe, and finally, we'll discuss the development and growth of the Spanish Empire during the 16th century. All right, the completion of any long journey starts with the first steps. So, ladies and gentlemen, AP US History, Unit 1, begins now. Let's go. It is generally believed that animal herds and other large animals migrated across the Bering Strait during the Great Ice Age, when sea levels were lower and a land bridge was exposed connecting North America and Asia, and they were followed by small groups of people from Asia that were following the animals as a source of food. The herds, and by default the people, moved along the ocean into the lower part of North America and eventually into South America. We will eventually refer to these migrants as Native Americans or Indians. The rapidly changing climate would eventually lead to the extinction of large game animals and required the Native Americans to increase their interaction with their environment in order to survive. Here's famous historian Alan Taylor. At the same time that the largest mammals became extinct, the environment became more diverse for the Indians. The changing climate and the demise of mega animals introduced the nomadic bands to pursue more diverse strategies to tap the broader range of food sources. The natives had to lean on their local environments more intimately to survive. The Indians began developing regionally in the Pacific Northwest, the American Southwest, which extends into present-day Mexico, the Great Basin and the Great Plains, and the northeastern region, which includes the Mississippi River Valley and the Atlantic seaboard. You may have heard during your time in school that powerful Indian empires developed, particularly in Central and South America, particularly those of the Inca and the Aztec empires. These empires won't be the focus of this video, but the Incas and the Aztec cultivation of one particular crop became rather important to some areas in North America, and that crop is maize. Maize was corn, but in about 1500 BC, the Central American Indian tribes learned how to create maize hybrids that have multiple ears, protective husks, and cobs with multiple rows of kernels. The maize became a central source and a significant source of food for those who cultivated it. The development of maize as a central crop to the survival of the tribes altered significantly the development of many groups of Native Americans. Maize led to the development of permanent civilizations because maize, if not carefully guarded, would be destroyed by pests, weeds, and droughts. Many tribes would develop advanced irrigation techniques to assure the constant water source as the cultivation of maize becomes more important to the tribe. these permanent civilizations led to the tribes depending on maize as a primary food source all year long. Additionally, now that some tribes had a surplus of food, social stratification occurred. This means that since there is enough food, some members of the tribe can focus on other things, like becoming merchants, developing crafts, being priests, and becoming rulers. And these permanent societies led to massive empires, as I said before, like the Incas and the Aztecs. Tribes that cultivated maize as their primary food source would similarly develop the same characteristics in Central America: permanent societies, economic and social diversification. The cultivation of maize spread northward into North America in the modern-day United States. In the American Southwest, Indian men reduced their hunting and became primarily the cultivator of maize. This is because in their relatively arid regions, the maize field required laborious construction of irrigation ponds and dams and ditches. However, in the central and eastern North America, things were different. Here's Alan Taylor again. However, the cultivation of maize arrived later in the central and eastern North America, and it required significantly less labor. Consequently, the native peoples regarded farming as an extension of gathering, which was a female responsibility, while the men remained preoccupied with hunting and fishing. This is an important distinction later. Maize planting reached the present-day American Southwest as early as 2000 BC and powerfully molded the Pueblo culture. The Pueblo peoples in the Rio Grande Valley constructed intricate irrigation systems to water their cornfields. They were dwelling in villages of multi-story terrace buildings when Spanish explorers made contact with them in the 16th century. Because Pueblo means village in Spanish, the Pueblo developed for a time into one of the more dominant societies in the Southwest. And later in the 1600s, the Pueblo will launch the most significant resistance movement against the colonization of the Spanish. But we'll come back to that later. Now let's take a look at the northwestern region of modern-day United States. Societies in the Northwest and present-day California supported themselves by hunting and gathering, and in some areas developed settled communities supported by the vast resources of the ocean. One example of these societies in the Northwest is the Chinook. The Chinook didn't have many permanent civilizations because of the lack of crops like maize. However, economic and social diversification happened because of their access to the ocean. They developed sophisticated fishing techniques and developed large ocean-going canoes due to the proximity to the massive trees in the forest nearby. This is a hunting-gathering society, but since the members of society have clear, unlimited access to the bounty of the Pacific Ocean, maize doesn't develop. The Chinook, too, will have surpluses based on the resources gathered from the ocean. As stated before, the presence of surplus food will lead to other professions and cultural developments. In the Chinook, they will be notable for their cultural expressions of the totem pole. And the totem poles weren't religious objects, rather stories about their culture. And moving to the Great Plains and the Great Basin, we see Native Americans interacting with the environment in an altogether different way. Societies responded to the aridity of the Great Basin and the grasslands of the Western Great Plains by developing a largely mobile lifestyle. Since these regions are so arid and have so few natural resources, the societies were unable to cultivate maize or permanent crops, so they had to follow buffalo or bison herds for survival. This mobile lifestyle also developed great warriors that would have hunting and intertribal combat as the core of their lived experience. Additionally, after the arrival of the Spanish in the 1600s, these tribes are going to take advantage of the European horse for both hunting and war. Additionally, these horses become the focus of social stratification because of the benefit it gives the tribes. One example of Great Plains, Great Basin societies are the Comanche and the Sioux. The Sioux, in particular, will develop into one of the most feared warrior societies in all of American history. It will be no surprise that the Spanish will have little success in conquering these regions. In the Northeast, the Mississippi River Valley, and along the Atlantic seaboard, some societies developed a mix of agriculture and hunter and gathering economies that favored the development of permanent villages. The mound builders in the Ohio River Valley and the Mississippi culture of the lower Midwest incorporated maize planting into their cultures, but overcultivation and drought led to the failure of these groups early on. However, these and other northeastern regions developed the use of maize with beans and squash, which led to the three-sister farming. Here's the author of your textbook, David Kennedy. The cultivation of maize, as well as high-yielding strains of beans and squash, reached the southeastern Atlantic seaboard region of North America in about 1000 CE. These plants made possible three-sister farming, with beans growing on the trellis of the corn stalks and squash covering the planting mounds to retain the moisture in the soil. The rich diet provided by this environmentally clever farming technique produced some of the richest population densities on the continent, among them the Creek, the Choctaw, and the Cherokee peoples. The Iroquois was the largest society on the Atlantic seaboard, which would be the closest to the size of the Incas and the Aztecs that North America could provide. The Iroquois lived in permanent societies and developed large alliances between the Iroquois tribes called the Iroquois Confederacy. This alliance sustained a robust military that menaced its neighbors, Native Americans and Europeans alike, for well over a century. Now we're going to begin investigating how contact among Europeans, Native Americans, and Africans resulted in the Columbian Exchange and significant social, cultural, and political changes on both sides of the Atlantic. First, we are going to explain the causes of exploration and conquest of the New World by various European nations. Let's discuss the causes of exploration and conquest of the New World by various European nations. Europeans were largely unaware of the New World, which were North and South America, aside from a Scandinavian expedition that was long forgotten by the 15th century. However, there were several indirect causes of European exploration to the New World, and one of the primary indirect causes began in Asia. By the 15th century, Europeans craved things from Asia, such as silk, opium, spices, and sugar. For these items to get to Europe, they needed to be transferred along a long land route that was heavily taxed by middlemen, especially from the dominant Muslim countries. The long route of taxation and transportation made these items so expensive that most could not afford them. So European countries looked at alternate transportation and supplies of these goods. Additionally, another cause of European exploration were scientific advancements that helped with navigation on the ocean, not the least of which was the development of the caravel. The caravel allowed the merchants to use the same ship to navigate the seas as well as the ocean. It used three masts with square sails on the front and the rear of the ship. The importance here is that the caravel was not only fast enough and sturdy enough to sail in both sea and ocean waters, but it was superior to other ships when sailing into the wind. In addition, the perfection of the compass, which provided confident navigation and the improved map making, allowed the ability to explore and greatly expand. Previously, sailing around Africa was preventative because the return trip was nearly impossible due to the wind conditions. A development that rivaled the importance of the scientific advancements were some economic inventions that helped with the international trade. Joint stock companies was just that invention. Before joint stock companies, explorations had to find a single investor that would risk a significant amount of money to fund explorations with the high likelihood of failure. And if the exploration failed, the investor would be ruined too. Joint stock companies, however, took out much of the risk of investing in exploration and colonization efforts. Joint stock companies pulled small investments from multiple investors. Since each investor contributed a small sum of money, more investors were willing to invest, and therefore more explorations were funded. However, these technological developments allowed the Portuguese to begin sailing down the coast of sub-Saharan Africa, where they will be able to develop trading posts where they could buy both gold and slaves off the dominant regional African tribes. Soon, the demand for slaves will increase rapidly. The Portuguese will take over some islands off the coast of Africa called the Canary Islands and the Madeira Islands. Here, the Portuguese and eventually Spain would grow their own sugar, the sugar that was so coveted in Europe. And the Portuguese and the Spanish will develop what will eventually be called the plantation system, where large farms will produce massive amounts of agriculture for commercial purposes. However, in this scenario, they will use primarily African slaves for the labor to grow sugar. In essence, the events on the Canary Islands and the Madeira Islands were a dry run for what was going to happen in the Americas. Here's Alan Taylor again. The conquest and transformation of the Atlantic Islands prepared for the discovery, invasion, and remaking of America. To colonize the islands, the Portuguese and the Spanish learned how to organize and sustain prolonged oceanic voyages that were predatory as well as exploratory, and also pioneered profitable combination of plantation system and the slave trade. Though we've already recognized Spain, the unification of Spain is another indirect cause of the European desire to explore and eventually participate in the conquest of the Americas. After the Spanish unification, Spain wanted to rapidly become a dominant world power. Here we're going to see that a common cause of the exploration and conquest of the Spanish conquistadors and explorers are going to be the three G's: gold, God, and glory. In other words, the country as a whole and individuals will seek gold through the direct extraction of gold or developing the desperately desired materials from Asia, God, the expansion and conversion of Catholicism to the New World, and glory, the desire to seek fame from new conquests of the New World. Think about the three G's when we see expansion efforts, specifically from Spain. Now, back to our story. Spain, like other countries, wanted access to Asian goods. Asia at the time was referred to as the Indies. This is going to be important later, since the name that Columbus will eventually give the Native Americans will be Indians. And the southern routes around Africa was dominated by the Portuguese. So Spain decided sailing west to get to the Indies was going to be the best route. A real quick pause to explain 15th century science. It was common knowledge at the time that the earth was round. So the idea that Christopher Columbus sailed the ocean blue to determine that the earth was round is false. As a matter of fact, many scientists had a good estimate of the circumference of the earth. Europeans had known for centuries that not only was the earth round, but the circumference was approximately 24,000 miles. What Europeans were wrong about was that they believed that there was almost 12,000 miles of open ocean between Europe and Asia, or what will eventually be called the Indies. So to review, the causes of exploration was that there was a large European demand for Asian products, a tremendous development of navigation technologies, and of course, gold, God, and glory. However, having access to slave labor will increase the chances of success of any permanent revenue-generating colony. And it was into this scenario that Christopher Columbus entered. The Italian explorer approached the king and queen of Spain at the time and said that he had a desire to travel west to find a new route to Asia. After the quick approval, Columbus and 90 men boarded 3 ships and began their western voyage. They first spotted land on October 12th, 1492. This initial sighting would be the Bahamas, and then he would travel further south to an area called Hispaniola, or modern-day Haiti. Though he didn't know it at the time, he was the first European to discover a new world that offered significant natural resources. After disembarking at Hispaniola, he met the inhabitants for the first time, the Tano people. Here, we see a common theme that will be throughout most interactions between the exploring Europeans and the Native American inhabitants, cultural confusion that will lead some Europeans to the view that Native Americans were uncivilized. Here's Christopher Columbus's first reaction to meeting the Indians for the first time. "They do not have arms, and they are all naked, and they have no skill in arms, and so very cowardly that 1,000 would not stand against 3 armed Spaniards. And so they are fit to be ordered around and make to work, plant, and do everything else that may be needed, and build towns, and to be taught our customs, and to go about clothed." Columbus is not the only European to be confused by the Native American practices, and the Indians' lack of clothing is not the only thing that will lead to the belief that Native Americans were uncivilized. Gender roles were going to be an initial focus of the cultural confusion between Europeans and Native Americans, especially in the Atlantic seaboard. The women tended to the crops while men hunted and did other tasks important to the tribe. This would be a shock to the early Europeans who arrived in the East. Europeans would see hunting as a leisurely activity and crop cultivation as men's jobs. So when exposed to the tribes, like the Iroquois and other Atlantic tribes, Europeans developed the belief that the Indian men were lazy. In addition to this, the general religion of the Native Americans will seem arcane to the European. Many Native American tribes believed that there were many souls and many gods existing among the environment. They believed in a spirit world that was present in all living things, and that if the gods or spirits were mad, the gods will prevent the animals from being found for hunting or bring forth a drought that prevented crops from growing. This belief system led to many Native American tribes to have a focus on balance in nature. In contrast, the vast majority of Europeans believed that there was one God and that the spirit resided within humans alone and that the environment is there to be used for the benefit of humans. This difference not only caused an insurmountable cultural confusion, but along with the perceived switch in gender roles and the manner of dress, the Native Americans were viewed as uncivilized and in need of civilization and conversion. The news of Columbus's successful voyages and innumerable resources in the New World led to a collision of the two ecosystems and an exchange of resources that lasted for 100 years. This exchange of resources between Old World and the New World was called the Columbian Exchange. The exchange will significantly alter both sides of the Atlantic. Out of the New World, Europe would receive American maize and tobacco, and most significantly, the potato. These food items were higher in calories than any crop Europe had. Particularly, the lowly potato had enough calories to sustain a population during winter months. The potato and the other American food directly led to a population growth in Europe because fewer people died of starvation during non-growing seasons. Another very important but long-developing change on the European side of the Atlantic was a slow change away from feudalism to a development of free market capitalism. Since new crops allowed for larger yields, farmers began growing and eventually selling their surpluses for a little extra income. This change will eventually allow farmers to break away from the exploitative feudal systems. America received European items too. Spanish horses, never seen before in America, changed migration patterns of Native American tribes in the Great Plains and the Great Basin. Additionally, America was introduced to plants like Kentucky bluegrass and sugarcane, which was a plant that Columbus himself brought over. However, the most significant exchange was the exchange of diseases from the Old World to the New. The Europeans, who had developed immunities from diseases in the last 100 years, spread diseases like yellow fever and malaria. But the most significant disease, however, was smallpox. Since Indians did not have immunities to diseases, smallpox and the other germs will kill 90% of the Native American population by the end of the next century. Smallpox was a highly contagious disease that was airborne in transmission. Typically, those who cared for the sick were the first exposed, and the cycle continued from there. Here's Alan Taylor again describing the effects of smallpox. After an incubation period of 12 days, the victims came down with a high fever and vomiting, for 3 or 4 days later with gruesome sores over their entire bodies. Painful, incapacitating, and disfiguring smallpox transformed people into a hideous mass of rotten flesh. The following excerpt is from a Mexican Indian describing the effects of smallpox on his tribe. They could not move. They could not stir. They could not change position, nor lie on one side, nor face down, nor on their backs. If they stirred, much cried out. Great was the destruction. Covered, mantled with pustules, very many people died from them. After the rediscovery of North and South America, it became clear that there would be a race between European powers to colonize and control the New World, especially between Spain and Portugal. 2 years after Columbus's initial voyage, the two countries agreed on the Treaty of Tordesillas, which created a line of demarcation. Spain and Portugal divided the New World up by drawing a north-to-south line of demarcation in the Atlantic Ocean, the east of which is open to Portuguese colonization and the west of which is reserved for Spain. The results of this treaty are still evident throughout the Americas today. For example, all Latin American nations are predominantly Spanish-speaking countries, with the sole exception of Brazil, where Portuguese is the national language. Though it is clear that the Portuguese got the lesser of the two, this agreement prevented significant conflict between the two countries due to the colonizations of the New World. And in order to facilitate colonization, the Spanish government developed the encomienda system in order to encourage conquistadors to establish colonial societies in what is now called New Spain. The encomienda system is an agreement by the Spanish crown to give colonists land in the New World, along with the permission to require labor from the Native Americans that were in that area. In return, the Spanish colonists were required to convert the Indians by allowing the development of churches and priests in the area, but also the recipient of the encomienda was required to protect the Native American citizens from attack from other Indian tribes. However, the encomienda system didn't turn out the way it was intended. For many, it turned into a system of slavery for the Native Americans under Spanish rule. The owners of the encomienda system grew profitable sugarcane to be sold in European markets and implemented the plantation system in the environments that allowed it. Additionally, some of the Spanish colonists even used Indian labor to mine for gold and silver in areas known to have mineral deposits. However, Native Americans proved to be poor at slave labor. The ability to escape and their exposure to disease led Spain to look outside the Americas for a slave labor population. The Spanish partnered with some West African groups who practiced slavery to forcibly extract slave labor for the Americas. As early as 1526, the Spanish imported enslaved Africans to labor in the Americas for plantation agriculture and mining. Adding to all of this, several conquistadors sailed to the New World to conquer land on their own. Many of these conquistadors, like Hernan Cortes and Francisco Pizarro, launched their quest on their own accord and without permission from the Spanish Empire. Their desire for gold and glory led to the rapid defeat of the Aztec and Inca empires, who were defeated by superior technology and disease. The gold and the cash crops from the New World will be sent back to Spain and kick off a growing money supply in Europe, and it continued to fuel the economic growth that further the desire to explore and conquer more of the Americas. The Spanish Empire in America grew quickly, and in 50 years, there were at least 160 new Spanish cities and dozens of new missions for the conversions of the native population. Now, not all of the Spaniards looked upon what was happening in New Spain as good. Debates in the Americas and in Spain raged on about the treatment of Native Americans. One Spanish friar in particular, Bartolomé de las Casas, was an outspoken critic of the Spanish policy in the New World. In his sermon in 1511, de las Casas denounced the encomienda system and the treatment of Native Americans when he said, "Are these Indians not men? Do they not have rational souls? Are you not obliged to love them as you love yourselves? The encomienda system is a moral pestilence invented by Satan." Later in 1552, de las Casas published a book called A Short Account of the Destruction of the Indies, where he wrote about horrific effects of the policies and the diseases on the Indians. "I call the Spaniards who plunder the unhappy people torturers. The Indians are our brothers, and Christ has given his life for them. Why then do we persecute them with such inhumane savagery when they do not deserve such treatment?" However, there were plenty of arguments within the Spanish Empire that the Native American tribes were truly unable to govern themselves. One person, Juan de Sepúlveda, debated directly with de las Casas when he argued the Spanish had a right to rule over Indians. "The Spanish have a perfect right to rule these barbarians of the New World and the adjacent islands, who in prudence, skill, virtues, and humanity are as inferior to the Spanish as children to adults, or women to men, for there exists between the two as great a difference as between apes and men." What will be fairly unique in the Spanish Empire that will largely not exist in the British colonies is the Spanish men's willingness to intermarry with the Native Americans. The intermarriage began a new race of people in the Americas called the Mestizos. The Mestizos were a mix of Spanish and Native American. However, the Spanish developed a caste system that incorporated and carefully defined the status of the diverse population of Europeans, Africans, and the Native Americans in their new empire. The caste system is a social hierarchy of status in society. Typically, mainland Spanish would be on top of the hierarchy, followed by those who were born in the Americas, and at the bottom of the caste system rankings were the mestizos and the African slaves. This rigid system would remain in place for many decades. Because encroachments on the Native American lands and demands on their labor increased, Native American peoples sought to defend, maintain their culture and prosperity through diplomatic and military resistance. For this, we'll have to go past 1607 all the way to 1680 to discuss the most impactful Native American resistance in all of North American history, the Pueblo Revolt, or as some call it, Pope's Rebellion. For this, we'll have to go back to the American Southwest and revisit the Pueblo. By the 17th century, the Spanish mission system had spread throughout the region, and dozens of Spanish friars migrated to New Spain to convert the Pueblos, and, just as important, to make sure they stay converted. As we view one mission, we can see the theme that the friars were very oppressive and viciously suppressed aspects of native religion that were still being practiced. Sometimes, when shamans would reappear, or if the Pueblo would add some of their original religious practices along with Spanish Catholicism, the friar would brutally beat them. And the tension between both the Spanish and the Indians would increase because many people actually believed that the Spanish friars in particular were the ones who were spreading the disease that had been killing a lot of the Pueblo population at the time. Here's Alan Taylor again. Backsliding into their old religion, or those who are resilient converts, suffered whipping with the lash and sometimes followed by smearing a dose of burning turpentine over their bloody back, which could prove fatal. One Spanish friar went on to say, conversion had to be reinforced by a fear and respect which the Indians have for the Spanish. So in 1765, a new wave of disease hit the Pueblo population, and many of the natives believed that the Christian God had not protected them from smallpox. The shamans began reappearing, and the Pueblo began practicing the religion from before the conversion. When the friars found out about this, they had 47 shamans whipped and arrested for sorcery. One of those shamans who were whipped and arrested in 1675 was a Pueblo by the name of Pope. Pope, in 1680, organized and executed a revolution against the Spanish colonizers. As the revolution spread throughout the region, Pope's rebels targeted mission churches and the friars for most of their retribution. By the end of the Pueblo Revolt, the Pueblos killed 20% of the Spanish colonists in the American Southwest, and they killed 50% of the friars while burning down all of the churches. The Pueblo, for the first time in the 16th century, have control of the region. The Pueblo Revolt was the most successful of the Native American rebellions in American history, but it was only temporary. By 1692, Spain was able to regain control of the area. However, when the Spanish regained control, they compromised with the Pueblo in order to limit rebellions in the future. First compromise, the Spanish agreed to abolish the encomienda system. Now, this is only in the Pueblo region. The encomienda system is everywhere else. But second, the Pueblo were allowed to use some of their traditional religious practices while still following most Spanish Catholic practices. As we approach the end of the video, I want to leave you with some final thoughts, which are basically the last few paragraphs in chapter one from your textbook author, David Kennedy. And I want you to really think about this. We've spoken about a lot of negatives during this video, but Kennedy is going to provide a little nuance, and I want you to think about what you think about this. Do you agree with what Kennedy is going to say? Here's David Kennedy, author of The American Pageant. The misdeeds of the Spanish in the New World obscured their substantial achievements and helped give birth to the Black Legend. This false concept held that conquerors merely tortured and butchered the Indians, killing for Christ, stole their gold, infected them with smallpox, and left little but misery behind. The Spanish invaders did indeed kill, enslave, and infect countless natives, but they also erected a colossal empire. They grafted their culture, laws, religion, and language into a wide array of native societies, laying the foundation for a score of Spanish-speaking nations. Clearly, the Spaniards, who were more than a century head start over the English, were genuine empire builders and cultural innovators in the New World. As compared to their Anglo-Saxon rivals, their colonial establishment was larger and richer and was destined to endure more than a quarter century longer. And in the last analysis, the Spanish paid the Native Americans the highest compliment of fusing with them through marriage and incorporating indigenous culture into their own, rather than shunning and eventually isolating the Indians as their English adversaries would do. All right, ladies and gentlemen, we are at the end of the first video, the first chapter, and the first unit of AP US history. The question will now be, how will the colonization of the New World by the other European countries be different from the dominating start of Spain? How would the small colonies of Britain grow so powerful that they will eventually be able to declare independence and establish their own young country, which will be eventually called the United States? Well, we'll just have to wait and see.